Blessed be the one holy and living God.
Glory to God forever and ever.
Praying together, Almighty God,
to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Samuel. David again gathered all the chosen men of Israel, 30,000. David and all the people with him set out and went from Baal Judah to bring up from there the Ark of God, which is called by the name of the Lord of hosts, who is enthroned on the cherubim. They carried the Ark of God on a new cart and brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which is on the hill. Uzzah and Ahio, the sons of Abinadab, were driving the new cart with the Ark of God, and Ahio went in front of the Ark. David and all the house of Israel were dancing before the Lord with all their might, with songs and lyres and harps and tambourines and castanets and cymbals. So David went and brought up the Ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom to the city of David with rejoicing. And when those who bore the ark of the Lord had gone 6 paces, he sacrificed an ox and a fatling. David danced before the Lord with all his might. David was girded with a linen ephod. So David and all the house of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouting and with the sound of the trumpet. As the ark of the Lord came into the city of David, Michal, daughter of Saul, looked out of the window and saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord, and she despised him in her heart. They brought in the ark of the Lord, and set it in its place inside the tent that David had pitched for it. And David offered burnt offerings and offerings of well-being before the Lord. When David had finished offering the burnt offerings and the offerings of well-being, he blessed the people in the name of the Lord of hosts and distributed food among all the people, the whole multitude of Israel, both men and women, to each a cake of bread, a portion of meat, and a cake of raisins. Then all the people went back to their homes. The word of the Lord. Hope on Christ might live for the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you had heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and had believed in him, were marked with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit. This is the pledge of our inheritance toward redemption as God's own people, to the praise of his glory. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Herod, and his guests, and the king said to the girl, "Ask me for whatever you wish, and I will give it." And he solemnly swore to her, "Whatever you ask me, I will give you, even half of my kingdom." She went out and said to her mother, "What should I ask for?" She replied, "The head of John the Baptizer." Immediately she rushed back to the king and requested, "I want you to give me at once the head of John the Baptist on a platter." The king was deeply grieved, yet out of regard for his oaths and for the guests, he did not want to refuse her. Immediately the king sent a soldier of the guard with orders to bring John's head. He went and beheaded him in the prison, brought his head on a platter, and gave it to the girl. Then the girl gave it to her mother. When his disciples heard about it, they came and took his body and laid it in a tomb. The Gospel of our Savior.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. This is a great joy and privilege for Ann and me to be back here. It's all this electronic equipment, it's a little intimidating sometimes. I think remember the story of the old retired priest who came up and tapped on the microphone and said, "There's something wrong with this mic." And the congregation immediately responded, "And also with you." But during the pandemic, I preached a few times at Christ Church in Sausalito, where we live. More specifically, I preached to a cell phone camera on a tripod in an empty church on a Saturday. It's a very strange feeling, preaching to an empty church. In my head, I knew that there would be people watching the next day at home on their computers, as would I. But my gut told me that I was preaching to an empty church. No response, no head nodding, no smiles, not even a yawn. It felt weird, it felt artificial, and frankly, a bit lonely. So I'm glad you all are here this morning, and Anne and I are very glad to be back here. St. Mary's is a great parish with a great history and a great future. And the music is terrific too. It's good to be back. As we wind down this past 16 months of isolation, of shops and restaurants and concerts boarded up, face masks, working or going to school at home, as we come to the end of that, celebration is in order. Holy Communion at home in your pajamas in front of a computer doesn't quite do it. When people come together to give thanks for a victory or for the end of a particularly hard time, we give thanks. We have a party. It's party time in our Bible lessons this morning. In the first lesson, King David was having a party. They were leaping and dancing before the Ark of God as it was brought up to the holy city of Jerusalem. The Bible says David danced before the Lord with all his might. David offered offerings before the Ark of God and fed the whole multitude of Israel, to each a cake of bread, a portion of meat, and a cake of raisins. Sounds like a pretty good party, doesn't it? In the gospel reading, King Herod was also having a party on his birthday, even though it didn't end very well for John the Baptist. So we could call today's sermon, "Come to the Party." You know, I can't remember ever preaching on this passage in Mark's gospel before. It's not a particularly easy one. I don't blame your rector for being on vacation this Sunday. The beheading of John the Baptist and Salome's famous Dance of the Seven Veils have been the subject of plays and operas and paintings. And interestingly, Jesus never appears. I can't think of any other gospel reading in our whole three-year cycle where Jesus doesn't appear. What's the message here? What is God saying to us in this horrific account of the violent end of a great prophetic preacher? Where's the good news? John the Baptist was a profile of courage, a man of conviction, determined that he had been called by God to prepare the way of the Messiah with a call to repentance. John was cut from the mold of the great Hebrew prophets. And John confronted Herod over his adulterous marriage to his brother's wife, an act that John considered a moral outrage. And King Herod Antipas was a conflicted man, seeking his own power and glory, while at the same time trying to keep the peace in Galilee, avoiding any conflict that would force a Roman intervention into his territory. And Herod was giving himself a birthday party, and his niece / stepdaughter, Salome, does a dance. Such a memorable dance that Herod promised her that she could have anything she wanted, up to half of his kingdom. When she asked her mother what she should request, the response was, "Ask for the head of John the Baptist." Now, one interpreter suggests that this story raises the issue of Herod sticking to his promise regardless of the cost. And we can ask, is that an admirable trait? Or in this instance, a spineless move. And the task of following Jesus will never be easy. We still live in a world where those who are entrusted with political power live in fear that their authority will be challenged. Our leaders may or may not be as outwardly wicked as King Herod, but they're often just as spineless, committed to expediency and willing to compromise truth and justice and compassion if they think it will win them some votes and guarantee their election. 2 weeks from today, the gospel describes a second contrasting ceremonial meal. It's Jesus, it's a contrast from today's birthday party for King Herod. 2 weeks from today, we hear Jesus' feeding of the 5,000 in the wilderness. And Mark is a very deliberate writer. He wants us to sense the contrast in the stories of these two different meals. While Herod's was a banquet of death, we will realize that Jesus calls us to a banquet of life. Herod could have made a different choice, but power, prestige, and self-preservation had replaced God in his life. Though he actually loved to listen to John the Baptist, he would not risk his reputation and the respect of the people in order to spare John's life. I hope we can all see a warning here. We're always in danger of making choices that undermine our faith and align us not with God's kingdom, but rather with the principalities and powers of this world. A little compromise here, a little laziness there, and suddenly we wake up in a place that is far removed from where we should be standing as a faithful, committed follower of Jesus Christ. Our lives are filled with choices. Herod chose loyalty to his kingdom and the power that it afforded him. Herod presided over a banquet of death. Jesus calls us to a banquet of life, a life worth living. Jesus invites us all to come to his banquet, speaking the truth no matter the cost, working as best we can to bring justice to all, and living lives of compassion and concern for those in need. Jesus calls us to live beyond ourselves, to find strength in his feast, in his body and his blood. He invites us to come to the banquet, his banquet. It's time to party. Amen.
Through him all things are made. For us and for our salvation, We offer prayers for ourselves, our nation, and the world. We remember all our brothers and sisters who minister in our own church. Michael, our presiding bishop, Mark, our own bishop, and the clergy and people of this congregation. For your family, we pray.
Be with us and bless us, Lord God.
We pray for our nation. Shed your grace on all of us and bring us to a more perfect union. Guide those who lead our country and all who share the task of governing. For our nation, we pray.
Be with us and guide us, O God.
We pray also for all people throughout the world, gathered in the human family, that the fullness of justice and compassion may be extended to those most unloved, those who have been victimized and subjected to violence, abuse, and discrimination. We especially pray for the people of Indonesia, Bangladesh, Portugal, and all nations and tribes where the pandemic cases continue to rise. For the welfare of the world, we pray. We pray for those whose body aches, whose heart is weary or frightened, whose mind is clouded or cast down. Send your spirit to fill them with your healing. We especially pray for David, Herman, David, Connor, Sue, and those you may wish to add. For all who suffer and struggle, we pray. We pray for all those who have died and those who mourn them. Draw them to your loving embrace and to the life of eternity. We especially remember Robert Hallbauer, Gail Berry, Richard Boyle, Robert Roy Figone, and those who may wish to add. For all who have entered new life through Christ's resurrection, we pray.
Be with us and uplift us, O God.
We pray for the many blessings of our lives, including the gift of life, relationships, and being together. We give thanks for all who share their lives with ours, and especially for the ministry of the very Reverend Lynn Knight and his presence with us today. For the confidence that you are with us always, we pray.
Be with us in your grace, O God.
O Holy One, the author of righteousness, accept the prayers we offer for our nation. Grant us the integrity to take bold steps that will shower all creation with the harmony and justice that you so desire for us. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, and through the guidance of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins to God and our neighbor.
By what we have done and by what we have left undone.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life. Amen. Please stand. The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Hey, darling, careful of the camera. Don't bump into it, please. Please be with me.
St. Mary's, it is so nice to see you! Welcome. My name is Mike Stafford. I am the interim associate minister here at St. Mary's, and now a fully 4 weeks on the job, so hey. First of all, welcome to anybody who is visiting us for the first time, or the second time, or the fifth time. We are absolutely overjoyed that you are here with us, and we hope that you make yourself known to our community. We hope that you make yourself known to our newcomers greeters, and you can get on our list and become part of the fuller life of this community of God. But we are just absolutely thrilled that you're here. I'd also like to welcome those of you who are streaming online through that camera right there, right in the front of the first pew. Hi, welcome via cyberspace, and we're really glad you're here with us as well. We are streaming right now live to Facebook and our website, so definitely encourage friends and family, you guys too, to join us any given Sunday at 10 o'clock over the summer. And if any of you or any of you are inclined to join our streaming ministry and can come up with fabulous ways of making this experience and this online experience even better, you are very, very welcome to join us in that. And I actually want to give a very special thank you to Laura, who is manning the iPad right now. Laura, can you lift up the iPad? And so she's got it going. That's our connection to the internet right there. So thank you so much. We really appreciate it. Welcome to our simple summer at St. Mary's. As you guys know, David is on vacation. So really, really special thanks to Lynn for being here. Lynn, you are a huge gift to our community. You've been a huge gift to our community over and over again. We're gonna keep on asking you back. You keep preaching like that, absolutely. Just a couple heads up. We've got just a handful of announcements. One, our normal offertory plate collection won't look normal. We would love for you to continue to give monetarily to St. Mary's to continue the work that we are living more and more and more into. There will be plates in the back, so on your way out, don't forget to donate there. Also, if you are here or if you are online, please feel free to donate using the church website, smvsf.org. Great, easy ways of making that happen. Communion. So thank you, by the way, everyone in the church being masked. It is part of the regular rules. We're going to encourage you to stay masked. At communion, our communion is bread only. We're going to continue that practice until we get updated guidelines from the diocese. When it's time to receive communion, as the usher indicates, go ahead and go to the altar rail. You can kneel, you can stand. Our clergy will be masked as well. They'll drop the bread into your hand. You'll carry the bread back with you to your pew, and then you can remove your mask, eat it, and then be extra holy. It's fabulous. So those are the directions for communion. We do have lay Eucharistic ministers and visitors who will be bringing communion to folks who cannot join us in person. So if that is something that you online or you know people who are needing the communion and wanting that as part of their sacramental experience, have them get in touch with the church, and we can make sure people get out to you. Last two announcements. We have signups for our next Sacred Ground circles. This is the race dialogue that we've been having within the church. The new circles start in late July. Signups need to happen now, though. So if you would like to sign up, we'll have more in the fall, but if you'd like to sign up, do so immediately. And if you know people, anybody else, not just St. Mary's, it could be any other Christians, non-Christians, anybody who wants to be a part of this kind of looking into ourselves and our experience of race and our history of race in our country, both individually and collectively. It's a really phenomenal curriculum, and encourage them to sign up as well. Finally, you've been receiving in your announcements recently a save the date for our retreat, our parish retreat up at the Bishop's Ranch in October. Well, we can sign up now. I just heard the other day, so it didn't make its way into the bulletin, but you will be receiving an email later this week with a link. A fabulous chance. It's the weekend of October 15 to 17. It's a fabulous chance to get out of the city, to be in one of the most holy, beautiful spaces. It's up in Healdsburg, wine country, rolling hills, cow farm. I mean, you can't do better than that. But be with the parish, connect with the parish. It's a great way to get to know other people really well. But signups for St. Mary's alone, we've been given first chance to sign up. So because instead of signing up as a group, we're going to sign up individually. So signups happen on the bishop. You'll follow the link, you'll follow the instructions when it comes out to you. But we really hope for a great turnout, because of course, with any kind of community, the more the merrier. And as Lynn said, it is time to party. And that's a great way to make it happen. All right, Lynn, if you could lead us up to the altar for the next stage. Thank you.
Walk in love as Christ loved us, and he gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. Thank you. Almighty God, creator of heaven and earth, for you are the source of life and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Thank you.
Keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of God's Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and among those for whom you have prayed this day and forevermore. Amen.
Thanks be to God.